coordinates. Let me rewrite again what is the metric. So the good thing about these coordinates is that the light cones remains at 45 degrees. So let me remind you. So first of all, they are called tortoise coordinates. I don't know if it is something that people know. So it's this ancient myth about Zeno's paradox. Sorry, I don't know. This is something that we study in the schools in philosophy in Italy. So I'm not sure how spread this is. I mean, basically, it was this first discussion about limits. No, so the story was that there is Achilles and a turtle, and the issue was that Achilles is much faster. So, but the point that so first of all, Achilles should reach the point where the turtle is at the beginning, but by this time the turtle moved by a bit, and then Achilles has to run and reach the point where the turtle is. And you can go infinity. So it was, I mean, a discussion about how to take limits. I mean, it was a very ancient thing. But anyway, so I think the name comes from this myth, this old ancient story, because the point is that in this situation you moved the horizon at infinity. Okay. So also, if you want, also in this case, it looks that it takes an infinite amount of time to reach the horizon, which is at r star equal to minus infinity. Okay, but of course, like in the case of the turtle, is a fake. Okay, and notice the change between this form and the original Schwarzschild forms. Okay, so you remember last time we had this paradox that you have to reach t equal to plus infinity, but now in this form you also have to reach r star equal to minus infinity, okay, because the light cones remain open. And the horizon in this coordinate is r star equal to minus infinity. So this makes clear that whether or not something is infinity depends on the coordinate. So in other words, also in the radial variable, you have the same issue that in the original Schwarzschild coordinates you have for the time variable. So now r star equal to minus infinity looks to be infinitely far away, but the point is that you reach it at finite affine parameter. Okay, so you're going towards. So you see that r star equal to minus infinity corresponds to this parenthesis going to zero, of course. So the fact that it is at infinite coordinate distance does not imply that it is at infinite proper time. So the only good, the good thing about these coordinates is not that things become more clear because everything is moved to infinity, but it has the advantage of being conformally flat, so that at least you have this simplification that light cones are always at 45 degrees. So what is the next step? So it's not clear, it's not that the situation is very clear in these coordinates, one can think about the following. So if one takes a light ray which is ingoing, okay, so I remind you that everything that has to do with the angular coordinates was suppressed, so we just have a two-dimensional problem. There is only time and the radius. So you can ask what happens if I take a light ray which is falling into the black hole. Now the light ray will cross the horizon in a finite affine parameter for the same reason that we discussed about the proper time. Also in the case of analgesics, it will take a finite affine parameter. So the idea is the following. So of course in this geometry, light rays will satisfy. So if I define a variable which is t plus r star, lines of constant v, so a line of constant v corresponds, for example, if I send t to plus infinity and I send r star to minus infinity, keeping this constant, it corresponds to following this ingoing light ray. Okay, so these lines of constant v are correspond to ingoing light rays. While if I use the variable u, which is t minus r star, this corresponds to, if I take a constant u, I can take r star going to minus infinity and t going to minus infinity. So this corresponds to a line u equal to constant. This corresponds to outgoing light ray. Okay, so let me focus in particular on this. So the one idea was discussed by Eddington and Finkelstein is to use, so since we have this problem that everything happens at infinity, on the other hand, if I take a light ray which corresponds to a certain v equal to constant, v remains constant as I go towards the horizon and I cross it. So if it seems that if I use the variable v as part of my coordinates, this should be okay, because v remains constant as I cross the horizon, okay? So let me try to use v as one of my coordinates, okay? So this is the idea. So these are coordinates which are called Eddington and Finkelstein. Okay. And the idea is just to use v and r as coordinates. So notice that I'm going to go back to the original radial variable. Okay. So okay, everything is defined. So in principle, we can do the change of coordinates. It's pretty easy because you see, if I look at dv, so dv is equal to dt plus dr star. Okay. So forget about the difference between I and r star. So if I take dv, so in particular, I take dt squared, so dt squared is dv minus dr star squared. So this means that if I put this inside the parentheses, dr squared cancel, okay? So you're left with, so there, in this form of the metric, there is no dr star term. There is only this term, which comes from the square of this, with the minus sign is in the top. Then you can convince yourself that okay, there are cross terms. Notice that the cross terms are dv dr star, but now there is this in front. But if you remember, this term times dr star is exactly what defines the variable dr star, so it is equal to dr. Okay, so what I'm saying is that you are left with this. Okay, so you can do it explicitly, so you can keep dr star, and then you are going to get dr star times this. But if you look at your notes, this combination is exactly what is called dr, so the original radial variable. So this is the metric in these coordinates. Yeah, so here I use the fact that 1 minus 2gm over r times dr star is equal to dr. If you look at your notes, this should be the case. Now, you see the advantage of this metric. Well, it has one disadvantage and one advantage. One disadvantage is that you are not, we are not so used to use null coordinates. Notice that nobody told you that you cannot use them. In a sense, every coordinate is okay. It's just a bit maybe not intuitive. On the other hand, there is a big advantage, which is the fact that when I reach the horizon, this parenthesis vanishes, and at the horizon, you are left with a metric with this form. Okay. So although it's a bit maybe unconventional, nothing is wrong about this method. So this is finite. Nothing goes to zero or infinity. It is just off diagonal. Of course, nothing is wrong. It's not degenerate. It's just finite and without any pathology. So already in these coordinates, you see that nothing really bad happens at the horizon. But there is something more that so this is the metric at the horizon. But the temperature is extremely high, no? Okay, let's press a bit. There is another thing that which is very clear in these coordinates. So let's study what are the light cones in these coordinates. Okay, so I want to study the motion. Of course, now the coordinates are V and R, and I want to see what is the derivative. So in the plane, I want to study the plane V R. Of course, be careful that this is a null variable. It's not time, right? But okay. And I want to study what is this slope, the slope of the light cone in these coordinates. Okay, so I ask dx squared equal to zero, a null condition, and I derive dv into dr. So there are two solutions corresponding to ingoing rays and outgoing rays. So in Minkowski, you get plus or minus one, so you get the two. Like in these coordinates. Here it's a bit asymmetric, so you get, of course, V is a null variable. It was chosen exactly to be such, okay? So dV equal to zero correspond to the light cone, okay? And in particular, it corresponds to ingoing light rays, okay? So, ingoing. The other solution, so you have to set this equal to zero, and you get, this, setting this expression equal to zero. So these are outgoing. Now let me plot. So if I am very far, very, very, very far away, so in this coordinate, this always part of the future. I'm talking about the future light cone, okay? So when I say ingoing, outgoing, I mean ingoing or outgoing in the future. So this staying at constant V is part of the light cone. The other solution for big R, this becomes, it's two, but it's, the important thing is that it's positive, it's like this. So this is the light cone. So if I am very far away, I can decide to escape to infinity, okay? And I can decide to fall into the black hole, okay? It's a bit unconventional, the fact that we are using coordinates in which staying at constant V is part of the light cone, but it's not different from using in Minkowski. If you use the same coordinate in Minkowski, you are going to get a similar result. Okay. Now, what is particular is that if I get closer and closer to the horizon, so let me put here the horizon, what happens at the horizon? The horizon, this vanishes, okay? So this means that this goes to infinity. So the light cone now is this and this, okay? So this number goes to infinity, which means that I move only in the V direction, basically, okay? So the derivative goes to infinity. So the future light cone is this. So we learn two things from this picture. So we learn, first of all, that if you are sitting on the horizon, there is no way to escape. Okay? Maybe it becomes even more clear if I go to even smaller radii, because even smaller radii, what you can easily check, this flip sign, and now you have this situation. Okay? So, this is, remember, the future light cone is all the possible direction in which a time-like curve can go, okay? And the message is that you can only go to even smaller value of the radius. Okay? There is no way to try to go back to infinity. Okay? So your future is smaller and smaller radius. Okay? If you are at the horizon, you can try to survive. You can keep, of course, you need a null geodesic, and you can barely stay there. But again, you cannot escape infinity. So you see now from this picture that what I was telling you that at the beginning. So we said, I mean, in these coordinates it's pretty clear that there are no pathologies at the horizon. We said that there is no curvature invariant which blows up. You see the metric at the horizon is smooth. There is no pathology, but it's not a place like any other. Something interesting is happening because the light cones tilt. And as it will become even more clear later, so there is no possibility to escape from this region to plus infinity. Another thing which is clear from this picture, as I was telling us a bit a few times ago, is that now you see that the horizon is a null surface. Okay. So naively, okay, if you are at the big radius, so you take a surface at constant radius, okay, what is that? I can take for example constant r, and I also can fix theta and phi, okay. So then only time moves. So this point moves in the time direction. Is a time-like curve. That is to say, if I stay at fixed radius theta and phi, I follow a time-like geodesic. In fact, when we're studying the gravitational redshift, I put two observers at fixed r, theta, and phi. Okay? On the other hand, if you stay at fixed r, theta, and phi at the horizon, you are moving on a null geodesic. Okay? So it's not that if you go even inside, you are moving now on a space-like geodesic. Okay? So this means that okay, the coordinates we're using are not very transparent, but so what we call in the Schwarzschild form is called R becomes, as we were discussing also at the beginning, once you are inside the horizon, becomes a time variable. In a sense that you see clearly going to smaller radii is your future. So this is a time variable. Okay. So maybe one way to think about it, just to not make it, so is that once you are inside the Schwarzschild radius, now the geometry is depends on time. Well, I don't know. There is still a time-like, there is the killing vector of time translations or T translations is still there. So because we hold the metric in such a way there is no T dependence. But I never checked that this T is something that we can moves in the time direction. Okay, so there is no T dependence, but inside the Schwarzschild radius, this T independence does not tell me that the space-time does not evolve in time. Indeed, it's a universe which is as we're going to see, it's crunching. Okay, so once you are inside, it's basically like being in a cosmology, in a time-dependent setup, which is crunching towards singularity. Okay? So I think what is very strange of this solution is that you look for something which is time-independent, but at the end you find yourself in a situation in which the metric does not depend on T, but the interpretation once you cross the horizon is that, okay, there is no T dependence, but this T is not time anymore, is a space-like variable, so there is independence of T, which is a translation. I should talk about the translation, not a time translation, but a space translation. So it does not depend on T, but the physics is the one of a crunching universe which goes towards the singularity. Okay. So of course, it follows from this picture that once you cross the horizon, your future is the singularity. So every observer which crosses it will end up in the singularity. And you can also check that it's contracting, the space-time is contracting towards the singularity. It's a bit, we didn't study it yet, but we're going to study cosmology, starting from next time, and One way to think about what is inside the black hole is some sort of big crunch, so the opposite of a big bang. So it's space time which is contracting towards the singularity. Any question? It's very clear. No. Now it will become more and more clear, I hope. But if there are questions about this. Okay, so unfortunately it will become a bit more complicated now. Because now, so far it's pretty transparent, because you say, okay, yes, I think I understood what I did wrong. The point was that the coordinates we were using, they were not clever to study the interior of the black hole. The reason is that, well, you see from here, it's clear that there is a coordinate singularity in the sense that the horizon is reached, so you call this surface t equal to plus infinity, but okay, it's a stupid choice of coordinates. Now, in these coordinates, you see there is no problem. I can follow ingoing observers, and nothing happens at the horizon. Very good. Unfortunately, it's not over yet. Let me do a disclaimer. Now we're going to study things which are a bit strange, so some of these features will not survive when I talk about astrophysical black holes. In the following sense, what we are studying here is what is called an eternal black hole. So it's a solution of Einstein's equation. Does not depend on t. Okay, so it's an object that did not form. So it's an object that somebody put there from the beginning of time, and it's a good solution. On the other hand, at a certain point, we should ask, okay, but I think, I don't know, but naively, all black holes in the universe, they form by some star that collapses. Okay, so I don't want a solution that is always there for all time. Okay, so I'm just, this is a disclaimer, I will come back, but just to say that some of these features that I'm going to talk about now, these will remain, but some of these features I'm going to talk about will not persist once it's a good solution, but then the question is whether it's the solution that we see in the universe or not. Okay, what is wrong about this metric? Imagine that for some reason you are interested to follow what happens in the past. Okay, so that's okay. So I look at the past icon, okay, which is like this. This is the past icon, okay? But you see that imagine that you are interested in following past icon. You see that a similar problem happens, similar to the one we had in the sparsing coordinates. Because if I follow something which goes in this direction, but in the past, I follow something which moves, for example, this part of the light cone, you see that it becomes tangent to the horizon. Okay, so if you want, I can put it here. So you see that if I look at the past light cone, this is what happens. Now, you can check. So the question is always the following, that what you read from these pictures is that if I look at the past going time-like curves, they cannot cross the horizon. It's very similar to what happened in the original Sparsi coordinates, because they become tangent to the horizon. But I can also anticipate that this will take a finite proper time. So the message is that these coordinates allow to follow future going geodesics inside the Schwarzschild radius, okay? But does not allow to follow past going geodesics, because past going geodesics, they have the same problem. So I reach V equal to minus infinity before crossing the horizon. Any question? Is this clear? So it should be clear from this picture, no? So you see that it's exactly what happens in the original coordinates. So the light cone bent in such a way that you cannot cross going backwards in time. You cannot cross the horizon. Okay, but as you can anticipate, this will just be a coordinate problem. Yes.
In this picture, we have two different light paths described by U constant and V constant.
Yes.
And we say for U constant path, if you are outside, we cannot cross the horizon, we become tangent. And the same is true also for the person who is inside. We can follow it, but it becomes tangent to the horizon. So the U path do not cross the horizon.
Well, be careful that, sorry, just to interrupt you. So, in these coordinates, we are not using U as a coordinate. So, by U constant, you are using U constant to say the other,
yes,
the other bunch, okay?
For them, it's not possible to cross the other side of what they were supposed to be in. They are, if you are outside, following a U path does not bring you inside. And vice versa, you cannot go out following a U constant.
Sorry, let's define it. Are you talking about the future or the past? Because
both ways.
Both ways. Well, both ways. It's not. I mean, it depends. Both ways. Okay. Which one? Because it's asymmetric, no? In a sense.
Yes.
For V. So what we're doing now is to use the U coordinates instead of V, and everything will be flipped. So in those coordinates, I can follow paths going in the past inside the horizon, but not in the future. So let me it takes a few seconds to, I mean, I can do the same thing by using U. As Asi say, now U, I remind you, U corresponds to. So imagine that you want to go inside the horizon, which means R star goes to minus infinity, so this goes to plus infinity, so U stays constant if T goes to minus infinity. Okay, so lines of U constant correspond to rays that go inside the horizon going backwards in the past. Okay, so let me write just a metric in these coordinates. Well, it's just a few small changes. So again, also U is null. The only thing that changes is this sign. And so let me separate the coordinates. So in these coordinates, if you do the same trick and you plot as a function of U and R, you plot the light cone, what do you get? You get the following. So far away, the light cone is like this. Here, the light cone is like this. Here is like this, and so on and so forth. Okay. So it's not so surprising in a sense. So you should think about this situation as a time reversal of this, you know. So you see that. So the in this picture, the past light cone is this. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that in these coordinates, if you look at the past light cone, it has this intuition. So the past icon tells you that once you are at the horizon, you can only go inside, or at most you can stay at the horizon. But the statement here are about going backwards in time, while the reverse happens if you go forward in time. So this part is very unintuitive, because you see, the picture that you get is that in these coordinates, you can only go out of the Hubble radius, okay? Sorry, there's a large radius. Okay, you should not be so surprised, because, of course, we are discussing about a solution which is not only time independent, but it's also time reverse asymmetric. So it must be the case that in this solution, if you have a situation in which things can only enter in the horizon, there must be also some correspondent statement that things can only exit. Okay. But we see that eventually some of these will be just a consequence of too much symmetry that we imposed on the problem.
So things can escape from this, things can escape from this eternal black. There are paths like this.
Yes, but as it will become more clear, but it's already clear for me. So notice that the two, because we are a bit, so in doing this procedure, we sort of explored, so let me start with the original spatial coordinates. There it was very problematic because whatever you try to do, you reach time equal to infinity, okay? Here, we concentrate and we say, okay, let's try to explore what happens because I reached a definite time. So I want to explore what happens when I go at t equal to plus infinity, okay? I explore and I discover that actually nothing happens and there is a new part of the manifold which is beyond the t equal to plus infinity, the original coordinates, which is described like this. Here, you are doing the same going to t equal to minus infinity, but these are two different parts of the manifold. Okay. So now, at a certain point, we'll have a complete picture of the manifold, and you will see that these are two different regions of the manifold. Okay. Okay, so now what we're going to do nothing is totally clear in these coordinates, but so we're going to do two steps. One is the step of putting u and v together so that everything will become completely confusing, okay? But then after that, there is a trick, and eventually we're going to come back to a form which is very transparent. But okay, I'm doing this as a sort of exercise, and also because it will be very difficult to guess how to jump from Schwarzschild to the final form. So it's a bit. Maybe I should keep this. Okay, so what we are trying to get is the following, is what is called a maximal extension. So at a certain point, so the situation is the following. We realized that in all these coordinates, in all these examples, in the Schwarzschild case, the tortoise coordinates, these coordinates, these coordinates, in all cases, there is always the possibility of taking one geodesic, follow it for a finite proper time, and end up at infinite coordinate. Okay? So a maximal extension is a form of the metric in which this does not happen. So I give you this metric and you can follow the geodesic for infinite time and you're always inside the manifold, okay? So it's a way to cover the entire manifold, okay? So these are you should not, it's not so strange. Think about the example I was making on the blackboard. It's like saying that all the forms that I gave you so far are just charts which finish somewhere. So it's like on the blackboard, I give you some chart that covers this part, and this boundary is called infinity. Fine, it's because I didn't choose the right coordinate, so nothing is wrong if I cross this, no? So far, we all have charts with this property. They cover a part, but either I follow in the past, in the future, I do something, I go out, I reach infinity, but I don't know what's next. Okay, so we want to go to what is called the maximal extension. So these are also called Kruskal Szekeres coordinates. Okay. As I was anticipating, that these were discovered in the 60s, so it took a bit of time to do all these steps that we are doing here. So, let me guide through some steps to get to that. So, first of all, you say, okay, now I use both U and V, so that I will be able both to follow these and to follow that. Okay. Unfortunately, I have to pay the fact that I'm using two null coordinates, which is not super transparent. The form of the metric is quite easy because, let me tell you that if you look at the definition of U and V, of course, the inverse definition, which relates U to R and T, sorry, there is minus sign, is by V minus U. Okay. So this is just the expression that I gave you, which the definition of U and V, just inversed. Okay, so you take this and you put it inside the tortoise coordinates. The tortoise coordinates were 1 minus 2gm over r times minus dt squared plus dr squared. Okay, so now you substitute this inside this, and what you get is you get the same object that was in front of the, you remember, the tortoise coordinates were like this. Okay. Now I plug these inside here. Well, you see, you are only left with the cross terms because u squared and v squared they cancel because of the signs. Okay. And there is also a factor of 1/2 because of this normalization. So you are left with minus 1/2. Any question about this? So I just did this. So let me ask you, because just so we are left with this variable r here. Okay, what do we do with this variable? Just to remind ourselves, because we are a bit lost. So now we have so the coordinates are u and v, but there is this symbol r that appears. So what is the meaning of this r? Right.
Depending on r star and r star is v minus.
Exactly. So now just to remind that, so we know that R is a function of R star. You remember that there was this, now we are using it, is the definition involving the log. The point is that I cannot invert it, so I would like to write explicitly what this is, but I cannot invert this expression. But in principle, there is a one-to-one mapping. Then of course R star now is this, so instead of this, I should this, it's R as a function of V minus U over 2. Okay. So it's a bit complicated, but it's implicit, but this is what it is. I also remind you that, always remember that this variable R is very important because it has the physical meaning of the radius of the two spheres. I never write it up, but here there is always plus R squared d omega squared. So that's why it's important to remember. Okay, so now everything is completely confusing. Well, it's still, let me try to manipulate this a bit. So as I said, R star is equal to this. If you look back at your notes, you will find that R star is equal to R plus 2gm log of R over 2gm minus 1. This was the relation between R star and R that I cannot invert. But let me, so I would like to write this as a function of R star. Again, I cannot do it, but I can do something. In a sense, I can write the following. What did I do? So I did the following. So I partially inverted this. In a sense, I brought this on the left-hand side, I divide it by 2gm, I exponentiate in such a way that I get this parenthesis. Okay. So now I have a mixed situation. So on the, let me do it. So on the left-hand side, I have R and U and V. Okay. So it's a bit mixed, but so then I divide by 2gm. Okay, I divide by 2gm, so I can put 2gm, I do this, and then I take the exponent of this, okay?
Minus R plus.
So there is a plus here. Okay. Okay, so you see what happens. When I exponentiate this, I get this, which it looks a lot like this, so I have to divide by R, so I get this extra term. But what is important is the following. So, okay, I still have a dependence both on R and on V and U. On the other hand, this part is completely innocuous, because nothing happens at the horizon. Okay, so at R equal to GM, this is equal to 1, and this is finite. So, it's a function that I cannot easily deal with. So I cannot explicitly write as a function of U and V, but it's regular, so I don't really care. So it does not do anything at the horizon. So it will blow up at the singularity. Okay, so it's important to keep it, but it's not relevant for discussing the horizon. Now I look at this. So this is regular. Now, you see what is the problem here? The problem is that, for example, well, it depends on which coordinates you want to follow. So, for example, let's follow. I want to argue that these exponentials they are exploding as I follow light geodesics inside or outside. Going inside the horizon, either in the future or in the past. For example, if I take V equal to constant, okay. So U. Well, I remind you that U. What is t minus r star? Okay, so v equal to constant, v is equal to t plus r star. So imagine that I want to follow an ingoing light ray. So this one. V equal to constant, t goes to plus infinity, r star goes to minus infinity, and this is a constant. But you see what happens to U. T goes to plus infinity, R star goes to minus infinity, so U blows up. So this is a problem, because this means that when I do this process, this exponential goes to zero. If I do the opposite, it will be that now U is a constant, T goes to plus infinity, V goes to plus infinity, so this blows up. So the message is that the form is not very optimal, so there is still something bad, not transparent that happens at the horizon. But you see also what is the solution. Of course, it's very easy to redefine variables U and V in such a way to hit the exponential. Okay. So I define variable big U, which is e to the is a minus sign, minus e to the minus U over 4gm. So I'm just saying that, you see, e to the minus u over 4gm du is the d of this big variable u. And the same for v. V is e to the v over 4gm. Okay. So you see, for example, for v, the d of this big variable is the same exponential, which appears here, times dv. And for u is the same. So there is this minus sign that it's this. Okay. So you see that this object is nothing more than d big U, d big V. Okay, any question? No, not really, so there are some factors, I apologize. There is some G appearing that now I will put, but what is important is that there is nothing more which is singular at the horizon. Any question? Okay, let me erase everything. So now there is one last step. So now the metric is basically something regular times some constant, d big u, d big v. But since we are not, we don't like too much null coordinates, instead of big u and big v, we go back, we go to coordinates which looks like time and space, in a way similar to this, are now big. So instead of now I have big u and big v, we can become big t, and big v and big v, we can big r. Okay. So you don't be, I mean, there's no reason to be afraid, in the sense, I want to stress the following. So first of all these steps that now I describe as, it took 50 years for people to do it. So it's not that, I mean, okay, maybe they were not so smart, but I don't know, but it's not that one day you, no, but it's very easy to, no. It takes a bit, so I'm describing the way to, but if you want, you can buy it and say, okay, if somebody is very smart, he will find the clever coordinates in which this happens. I'm trying to guide a bit the intuition, but this is not something that immediately comes to your imagination. Sorry, you want to ask?
I wanted
to Oh, thanks. Sorry. So you see, this expression is symmetric, and sometimes I just write two dvdu. So you. So in principle, I remind you that you should not do it in a sense that it's not obvious that we are talking always about the symmetric tensor. If I'm not talking about the symmetric tensor, of course there is no guarantee that that when I write the tensor in terms of the form dv and du, the prefactor could be not symmetric. But since when I talk about the metric, I already know that it's symmetric, I know that it's always appearing also the thing. So I was writing only one. I hope I took into account the factor of two, but I think I did. Okay, so I was saying the last step is to go back to variable u, big r and big t. And this will be the final form of the Schwarzschild metric. Okay, let me, let's do one step at a time. So let me write the form of the metric in this variable, in these variables big U and big B. So there are some numbers that comes from this exponent, but they're all regular. And there are like these. Okay, all of this is regular. And then there is d big u, d big v. The final thing is to write t is big u plus big v over 2, and big r is big v minus big u over 2. Okay? Nothing, so you go back and so let me write with some because I will need to make a plot. Okay, so I write here the final form of the metric. The final form of the metric is given by is exactly the same, but I just not surprisingly, it's just this. Okay. Notice that again, I said many times. Now R is a function of R star, and R star is a function of small v and small u, and small v and small u are a function of big U and big V, and big U and big V are a function of big T and big R. Okay? So there are many steps. You know, I want to stress, so this form of the metric is very useful to understand the structure of the horizon and so on. Of course, if I ask you to calculate the precession of the orbits using this variable, it's a bit... So what is important for us is that nothing happens at the horizon, so it is regular. Good, let me tell you also what is the relation between these final variables and the old variables, so the ones we started with. Okay. So you have to put together all these changes of coordinates, and at the end you get something which is not very difficult, and is this. So this is the hyperbolic sign of this. Okay. And this is the radial variable, which is this. Hyperbolic cosine of the same object. So it's not so complicated, no? Okay, at the end, this is the final. So if you don't want to go through all this, somebody comes and tells you, please use these variables, you do, and you get this form. Okay. So it's not, but to guess it is not so easy. Okay, so now let's study the final form of the metric. So these are called Kruskal-Szekeres coordinates or maximal extension of. Schwarzschild. Okay, let me draw something. Okay, so we want to discuss so this is big T and this is big R. Maybe I need some algebra, which I do here, because I want to know where the orbits are. So first of all, let's look at where the horizon is in these coordinates. Horizon means r equal to 2gm, the Schwarzschild radius. So you see that these vanish, but it's important that let me do the following. So. If I want something which is only dependent on the radius, I can take the combination of hyperbolic cosine and sine that gives you 1. So I calculate t squared minus r squared, and what I get is 1 minus r over 2gm e to the r over 2gm. So what did I do? I just square this minus the square of this sum to 1, and I get this in front. Two because I think it's good. Okay, so you see the following, that lines of constant radius are hyperbole in this plane. Okay, and in particular, the horizon r equal to gm corresponds to this equal to 0, so it corresponds to the lines t equal to plus or minus. So this is the horizon. Okay. So let's go step by step, because the maybe you didn't expect that the lines are the horizon. Okay, so if you want to plot a line of constant radius, for example, a line of constant radius is an hyperbola. For example, for r larger than 2gm, this becomes a negative, so are hyperbole like this. So if you want to take somebody that is a constant r, I remind you that always there is hidden, there are also the sphere, this we don't, so we're only talking about radius and time, but if I take somebody who's a fixed radius in these coordinates, it will plot, it will give you this. Okay? So it makes sense. So always check these things. So a guy or girl moving at constant at fixed radius outside the horizon, this is a time-like variable. Okay, indeed, this is a time-like curve. Okay, so it makes sense. Yes, let me also say, if I want to get the lines of constant time, I can take the ratio between these, time over radius, and this is equal to the hyperbolic tangent of t over 4gm. Okay. So lines, this is a line at constant radius with evolving time. Okay. These, on the other hand, are lines at constant t. So if I take a constant t, this fixes the ratio between t and r. So lines of constant t are, so this is t equal to a constant, while this is r equal to a constant. Okay, so you see an observer at fixed small r evolves like this.
Sorry?
R is
small.
What did you do? Oh, sorry. Thanks. Yeah, thank you. Sorry. Of course, big T and big R are the ones in this plane, while these are the original coordinates. Yeah, also these. Yeah, exactly. Good. I'm sorry. One thing that is important, actually, it should be the first thing to say, is that these coordinates, they are conformally flat. So light cones here in all this plane are always at 45 degrees. Okay, so the light cone, so you should look at this as in first approximation as you do for Minkowski. So the causality, the motion of light rays is the same as in Minkowski in this coordinates big T and big R. Another thing to notice. So, from this point of view, you see that, let me say another thing. So, if t goes to infinity, small t go to infinity, means that the hyperbolic tangent go to 1. Okay. So you see that now we understand a bit better what's going on, because this line has the name t equal to plus infinity. This makes a lot of sense because this was our problem at the beginning, that to cross this horizon you need to go to t equal to plus infinity. Right? You see that on the blackboard now it's completely artificial. It's just because I'm using coordinates that I use this hyperbolic tangent, and this goes when t goes to infinity, small t, I just go to this line. So it's exactly that, like the example I was telling you, that if I describe on the blackboard and I say that this is infinity, okay, I call it infinity, but nothing prevents me from going on the other side. Very good. Another thing that is very transparent from this is that the horizon, again, is a null surface. So the horizon corresponds to these lines, okay? So these are all null rays.
What do we mean by t equal constant outside the horizon for t equal to zero?
So yes, here I was describing this. So if I take a line of constant small t, okay, this corresponds to a line of constant small t drawn in this plane correspond to a line with constant ratio. Okay, so this is a line of constant small t.
Yes, but I mean, what is we know r equal constant. We have a particle which orbiting around the black hole. But what about what's the physical descriptions for t equal to constant?
Well, a line t equal to constant, of course, outside the horizon is a space-like surface. So you cannot hope that there is some observer following it. No, I don't have a precise meaning. It just tells you, if you want, that I'm just trying to show the relation between big R, big T, and small t, small r. So as time goes on, as small time goes on, I go from minus infinity, so this is a time equal to minus infinity. The hyperbolic tangent to minus infinity is minus one. So time, the clock, these are the lines of constant small t as time goes on. Okay. So it's just, sorry, what is the problem? So I'm just telling you that if I give you the value of small t, this fixes the ratio between t and r. Okay, so lines of constant small time is correspond to these lines, and as time proceeds, this line becomes moves from minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, so it shows also that okay, in this region, it's a good time variable. Okay, a good time variable is a surface that, so like Minkowski. T equal to constant correspond to a line like this, okay, which is space-like. Okay. So this is a good time variable. What is strange about this time variable is that at t equal to plus infinity stops here, and at t equal to minus infinity stops there. Okay. You seem a bit... No, I understand that it's not that so transparent. Okay, let me show where the singularity is. Okay, we said that at r equal to 0 there is really a pathology, so we cannot save gr from that. R equal to 0 corresponds to this equal to 1, so it corresponds to this hyperbola. So I don't know how to cross this line. So here is a big question mark. Okay, so everything GR makes sense until this line. There is also another solution, which is here. Okay, because of course I have the two solutions. So also here I don't know what's going on. So as I said, now we're going to discuss about this, but everything is a bit artificial because there is a time reversal symmetry, okay? So at a certain point we're going to discuss, but forget it for a second about this. Okay, so let's look at the first part. So here, let's look at these two regions. Okay. Here, and forget for a second about this region and this region. Okay, here it sort of makes sense because, well, first of all, we see also that when we cross the horizon, which is this line, okay, once you are here, your future is only the singularity. There is no way to escape to infinity again, because this is null. Okay? So if you are inside here, your future is the singularity. Okay? So as I told you, you should think about this region as some sort of evolving, crunching metric. Okay, so you are there, your future is just going to reach a singularity. Here there is infinite curvature, so you are going towards an infinite curvature region. If you are here, you are more relaxed, because first of all you can escape to infinity, okay? And okay, the space-time is not clear for this part, but it's asymptotically flat, as we saw in our coordinates. Okay, let's at a certain point discuss about, so this is what is called a black hole. This sometimes is what is called a white hole. All right, so let's face this part. So why, as I said, it's not surprising that we get a solution like this. So we imposed that this solution is time reversed asymmetric, okay? So if you have a region in which things can only enter and they reach a singularity, by time reversal symmetry you also have the opposite object. Okay, so everything is symmetric and reflection. Okay. In what sense I say that this part, I'm not saying that this solution is extremely interesting, because as we discussed, we're also talking about black holes, not only when we, when we want to discuss real astrophysical objects, but when we want to discuss the information paradox, and so on and so on. So this is a good solution of general relativity, so it's important to understand it. But let me compare this to astrophysical black holes. Okay. Astrophysical black holes, from all what we know, all of them they form, there is a star that at a certain point collapses. Okay. So this means that at the beginning, I have a Schwarzschild solution, which is only valid outside the surface of the star. For example, you take our Sun, it's already Schwarzschild, good approximation, but only outside the surface, so there is no singularity. At a certain point, for some stars, the surface shrinks and it becomes smaller than the horizon. Okay? So if I draw in this picture the surface, okay, the surface of the star evolves, and so it's a curve which is time-like. Okay, so imagine that there is somebody on the surface, so it's time-like. And at the beginning, let's assume that it's big enough and it's not a black hole. Okay, so you have some picture like this. Well, it should remain time-like. So now, as I said, the Schwarzschild solution is valid only outside the surface, okay? So you see two things. First of all, that everything which is on this side, it cannot be trusted. So this white hole does not exist, and also this region does not exist. On the other hand, it's very important that this region, the region from which you cannot escape, okay, so all the features of the black hole really exist, in the sense that at a certain point the surface is there. I cannot trust this part of the geometry, but this part, including the fact that there are observers that cannot reach infinity, is valid. Okay, so this is that, from this point of view, that's why we always talk about black holes and not white holes, because this part exists if it's a solution, but not all solutions are realized in nature. Well, we don't really know. I mean, I cannot exclude the fact that. What about this region? Again, this region only exists if I trust this solution as it is, as a fully time-reversal solution. But notice that it's funny. There is another asymptotic region. Okay, because this region is similar to this, I mean, it's the same basically, but it's not the same, it's a different region, so it's a different region. So the picture, notice also that this region and this region cannot talk to each other, because there is no way to send light, since they are, so I cannot send a light signal from here to there, okay? So we cannot explore the physics here. Okay, so the picture is that there are two asymptotic regions which are sort of joined through this geometry, but okay, this part of the geometry is called Einstein-Rosen bridge.
Which part?
But I mean the there is some sort of wormhole, so the connection between
I don't really know whether this is something very specific.
It's a good question. I don't know what is. You say that there are two asymptotic regions which are connected by this geometry, but in a way in which you cannot transmit signals. So this vaguely is called Einstein-Rosen bridge. I'm not sure if there is a precise. So let me stress that again. You should look at this geometry in two ways. So you may have heard that recently, for example, when you study ADS-CFT, so in this case you're not interested in astrophysical black holes, but you have the solutions, and you're really interested in the physics of the full solution, including the two asymptotic regions. Okay. So I don't know, you probably were in Maldacena's talks, and you remember he was talking about wormholes. Okay, he was talking about the geometry like this. Okay, I mean in this case the idea is that either you can, whether you can form it or not. But anyway, so this is what would be called a wormhole. Wormhole is a connection between two asymptotic regions. So there are two regions which are flat space, then they are deformed. So each, so imagine that you live here and there, okay? So the geometry is such that if I'm far away from the black hole, I don't see anything. When I go close to it, of course everything is space-like, so I cannot do it as an observer, but at least I can follow a space-like line. So following this, I go from flat space, I go closer to the black hole, and I exit in another place in the universe, which is another asymptotic region, okay? Depending on whether, so this is called a non-traversable wormhole. Okay. If, on the other hand, it's possible for a time-like curve to go from one side to the other, it's called a traversable wormhole. Anyway, so I don't want to confuse you. So I think it's important, as a first step, it's important to say, okay, real black holes, the one that we study and exist in the universe, they only have to do with this part of the geometry. Okay. On the other hand, if I want to, for more theoretical studies, it's interesting to look at the full geometry. This not there are other cases which are even more complicated. If you look at the Reisner-Nostrom geometry, which are a geometry for a Charles black hole, in many cases there are even more than two asymptotic regions. Okay. But again, I'm saying this just to say every time. Look at these geometries, which are nice, they are full solutions of Einstein's equation with a lot of symmetries. Of course, then, whether the full geometry applies to the universe is not obvious. Okay. Yeah.
Up to this point, we came doing all kinds of coordinate transformations, and we now have a bigger manifold that we started than what we started with, right? Like, our normal coordinates is just one quarter of this picture.
Yeah.
So, how can we judge that the new parts are actually there in the manifold, but not some? Like, we just transform coordinates and we produce more parts.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry, is this a question?
The question is justifiable that we do things like this, or maybe I can write another kind of coordinates and I end up with another manifold structure. So.
Well, first of all, always put things in order. In a sense, the manifold is the real mathematical object. Then the coordinate that you put are just a local description of the manifold. So from an abstract point of view, so the coordinates, so in a sense, this is the full manifold. Full in the sense that in this form there are no curves. So I can be sure that there is the full manifold because all the possible curves that I can draw, I can follow them in infinite affine parameter and always inside these coordinates. Okay. So your question make too much. So the coordinates are just a representation. It's very similar to what I was saying. So imagine that I tell you, I give you coordinates of this patch on the manifold, and I ask you. Can I trust also the outside? Well, unless there is a, I would say that there are different levels of questions. So first of all, if you impose all the symmetries that we imposed, this is the full solution compatible with the symmetries, and you can ask. At the beginning, I only had this portion of the manifold. Well. It's clear that I didn't have the full solution because I had the curves that was exiting your coordinates, so I was really in a situation very similar to this. So I was just describing a piece. Now, whether the full manifold can be trusted or not, then it becomes a bit a question of also physics. In a sense, you have to enter a bit into the details, but so. in other words, if you impose all the symmetries and you trust that the symmetries are exact, then of course the solution is everything you can reach following finite time geodesics. So the full manifold is a solution. Now, if some of the assumptions are a bit not really realized in nature, then some part may not be. It's not a question of not being part of the manifold. It's just that your assumptions do not apply, for example, in this region, and then you have to change solution. But in general, apart from this, you always have to think about coordinates as some sort of representation of a part of the manifold. But the manifold will be, as an abstract concept, something more fundamental, and we are exploring varying parts of the manifold.
But I can be sure that using another coordinate chart does not affect the results that we get from this picture.
Well, the abstract concept of manifold. So a manifold is a topological space with all the possible compatible charts. So the concept of manifold already assumed that all the possible charts can be used. Unless you do something pathological with the manifold, all possible coordinates that they can use, since by definition they must be compatible with the other, so there must be a smooth change of coordinate one to the other, you cannot change the structure of the manifold. Once you find coordinates, and in these coordinates all curves can be followed at an infinite affine parameters. So there is no other regions that I cannot. So it's not that some observer goes out of these coordinates. Then all the possible other coordinates that you can use, they must be compatible with these. In the sense, they must have a smooth change of coordinates. So everything cannot change what I learned in these coordinates. That's why it's important to reach the maximum extension, because then otherwise you always have the doubt that you are describing the whole manifold. I think it's a good place to stop, unless there are no. Yeah. So this terminates our study of black holes. We are going to do a lot of exercises about black holes, and life is full of exercises about Schwarzschild, because you are going to meet this geometry many times. Also, there are not so many geometries that if you start going beyond this, everything becomes extremely complicated in doing calculations. So 50% of the exams are about Schwarzschild. So. Very good, we can stop here.